Hi, let's start by defining the term computational thinking, which is a term which you will see a million and one definitions for, because it's quite a difficult term to pin down. This is my attempt to define it. So computational thinking is where we use fundamental computer science principles to help solve problems. Now, what exactly those fundamental principles are will depend on who you ask, but we're going to look at three which are relevant to OCR paper two. Now, we're going to have a bit of an aviation theme to this video because I've picked this as an area where there are so many problems to be solved, both related to computer science and just generally. There is a huge amount of complexity here and a very, very daunting thing for anybody to go about trying to solve. If you were tasked with writing the program which scheduled the planes, or was for air traffic control, or you were tasked with trying to simulate a plane in a video game, all of that is very, very challenging, and you're going to want to employ some of these computational thinking skills to make it easier. It's almost impossible to do without using some of these principles. So the whole point is we want to use these fundamental computer science principles to allow us to better understand a problem in the first place. So I'm being given a job by my boss. I need to try and get my head around it. I want to apply some of these principles to make it easier to understand. And also, once I get going and start trying to solve it, I want it to become more manageable for me or my team to solve. So these computational thinking skills can be applied in real life, but also, of course, when you're programming, we want to be using these techniques to make our life a bit easier. Now, two keywords you'll come across in paper two are define and refine. So defining refers to this initial understanding. If I'm defining a problem, I am trying to understand its key features, what exactly has to get solved. And the word refining is going to pop up a lot in paper two. You'll get questions where you're asked to refine a problem or refine an algorithm. It means you're taking what is already there and trying to improve it in some way. So maybe it's inefficient and you're trying to make it more efficient. Maybe it's got errors in it and you're trying to make it work properly. So taking what's already there and trying to improve it. Okay, so the first of these three computational thinking principles is abstraction. So abstraction is simplifying a problem by removing unnecessary detail. And it's absolutely essential in computer science because both real life and computers are remarkably complicated. We cannot take into account every single detail. It's just not feasible. So the way this manifests itself in both exam questions and if you were a programmer, say, well, when you're defining a problem, you have to do abstraction as part of this understanding how the problem works. So to stick with this airplane theme, let's imagine you are having to create the program which shows this information at a gate at an airport. Well, the airport might be hiring you to make this program. They might give you a lot of information when they are telling you about this problem. Your job is to try and define it. Your job is to try and understand what exactly the problem is. They might give you lots of information. Not all of it is likely to be relevant to you solving this problem. So maybe you take a big paragraph like this and you do some abstraction and you try and pick out, well, what are the key details I actually need to understand to be able to solve this problem? And maybe you abstract it and you pick out these key bits of information. And you can often abstract multiple times if you need to. And so I might even abstract again and try and simplify it even further because it just makes it easier for me to be able to solve this problem. We also need to use abstraction when I'm refining my problems because, you know, I might have abstracted already and it might still be too complicated. So for example, I might have really, really understood how a fighter plane works. However, I might decide that I need to really abstract this further because it's not feasible for me to code every single feature in a real fighter plane because it's going to take me far too long and will just be a huge amount of money and time. So that might be a factor as to why I use abstraction when I'm sort of mid-project, but also it might be because I decide that actually I'm not really going for a super accurate representation. I might be creating a video game where it's meant to be fun. I might decide that actually all of the very, very intricate details of a plane are not going to be fun for my user to control. Really, the user just needs to be able to fly the plane fast, up and down, left and right, and rotate it. That might be it, right? I can simplify by removing lots of features if I decide that actually it's not necessary for my problem. So every time I use a program which is not exactly true to life, the developers have had to use abstraction to decide what was essential and what was not essential. Now, decomposition is another separate principle. It's sort of unrelated to abstraction, so try and separate it in your mind. Decomposition is breaking down a problem into smaller, more manageable subproblems. So The idea is these subproblems, you might have quite a few different subproblems. Each subproblem might get broken down further as well. But the whole point is that each of these subproblems should be able to be solved individually. A subproblem is smaller than your original problem. These are easier and more manageable to solve. But the whole goal is, at the end, once I've solved all of my individual subproblems, these solutions should then be able to be combined to solve the original problem, which can be easier said than done. It can be difficult to break it down and then recombine it, but it can be done and it can be a lot more simple to do than trying to solve the original massive problem. Now, we often represent decomposition using a diagram called a structure diagram. And we might do this at the start of my project when I'm still defining my problem. The way a structure diagram works is it's a hierarchy. So we have lots of rectangles. The rectangle at the very top represents our overall problem. So it's basically our problem, which hasn't got broken down yet. So let's say I'm trying to do the very, very daunting task of programming an autopilot for a plane. Well, that's a massive, massive problem. I cannot solve it unless I try and think about the component parts within the autopilot. Then I've got a chance at least of solving it. So a structure diagram will have multiple layers to it. So the next layer will be the first attempt to decompose it into subproblems. So I might, in my first attempt, decompose the problem of an autopilot into, well, it's got to change altitude and it's got to change direction. Those are its two big jobs. That might be my first go at breaking it down. Clearly, that is still a massive problem to solve. It's a lot of work to make a plane go up and down, lots going on. So I might decide to break it down further into other levels. So this is sort of what a finished structured diagram will look like. I've got multiple levels, potentially more than just three here. And I might have quite a few subproblems coming out of a problem. So you can see that I've started with two subproblems, but I've now decomposed them even further into more subproblems. The idea is the further down in the diagram you go, the more broken down these subproblems are. So the problem should get smaller the further down you go. Once you get to the bottom, you start solving these individually, then you start combining the solutions to solve the next level, and eventually they're combined to solve, hopefully, the original problem. Now we can also use decomposition to help us refine problems, and this is where maybe in an exam you'd be asked to do this. You might be asked to finish a structure diagram or suggest some improvements to a structure diagram. Maybe, using this example, I forget about the fact that an aeroplane has to change speed, so I stick that into my structure diagram, I give it again, I try and break it down into subproblems. And maybe I decide that actually roll control is a bit harder than I expected. Let me try and break it down further into a few more subproblems, which make it even easier to solve. So it's an ongoing process. When you decompose, you're constantly trying to break stuff down into more manageable chunks because programming is hard and we want to break stuff down to make it easier for us. And finally, our third and final principle within computational thinking is algorithmic thinking. We've defined what an algorithm is already. So what is algorithmic thinking? Well, it's identifying the precise set of instructions needed to solve a problem. I've underlined precise itself because that's what makes it algorithmic thinking. If you are able to do this precisely and in a very formal way, that's what makes it algorithmic thinking as opposed to just coming up with a rubbish algorithm. We use algorithms at the point where we are defining our problem still, because I have a problem. Let's say it's how to prepare the plane for landing. There are lots of steps you have to take to prepare it for landing. What steps do you have to do? In what order do you have to do these steps? What checks have you got to make? Well, here is one for landing a plane. They use an acronym, GUMPS, with different steps. The order is fairly important. Definitely, I could have broken down these instructions more into more detail. If I was programming a simulator, I might put this into code and I might have to do certain checks as part of this process. I might make it as a flowchart. I've got a set of steps which, when followed, will hopefully solve this problem. I won't try and refine this one because I don't know enough about planes to be able to refine it. But generally speaking, we might want to apply our algorithmic thinking skills to refine and improve algorithms, in particular, if the instructions are not quite precise enough. These ones here are not precise enough to be used by anyone who's not an expert, but part of your skill would be to try and make them more precise and more clear. But the big one for computer scientists is whether we can take the algorithm and make it more efficient. Now, the word efficiency is really, really vague. It's all about trying to maximize what you have. And there are two big aspects of efficiency which we need to be aware of. Speed is one of them. We want our programs to go faster. So can we change our instructions so that it will go faster? But one which is often forgotten about is memory. Can we try and minimize the amount of memory being used? And that will be linked to things like, is the code short? If the code is short, it will take up less memory. So it's not only speed, we also want to refine our algorithms to make things more efficient. And it'll be a common exam question where it asks you to refine an algorithm already existing. And often it'll be trying to make it go a bit faster or use less memory by making the code a little bit shorter. So look out for that in paper 2.